now I would like to introduce our lead speaker today to tell us about her incredible journey from leading a few to leading many. And she'll tell it best in her own words, but she, like many of us, was a professor at an academic center, decided she might make a career change, made a career change, and then a global pandemic hit. Who would have guessed? And she's in charge of procuring all of our PPE and vaccines. So super excited to introduce someone who inspires me every day, my sister, Minister Anita Anand. Anita.
Well, thank you so much. And thank you, Dr. Denberg and Dr. O'Byrne and Dr. Tai for your opening remarks, and to my sister Sonia for inviting me slash pressuring me to be a part of this wonderful day. I only say that jokingly because, of course, I am delighted to be here to speak with a group who cares so much about equity and diversity and inclusion, as do I. And Sonia's right. I can relate so much to your positions, not being in the medical field, of course, but being in an academic institution. I was a professor for 22 years. I had visited at a number of universities at Cambridge and Yale. I was the associate dean at the University of Toronto Law School. And I only say all those things because I can relate so much to your daily lives as being affiliated with university, being affiliated with research, and ensuring that academic institutions thrive. And that was really my mission, as well as mentoring students and applying for research funding and sitting on committees relating to choosing Canada research chairs and caring about equity and diversity and inclusion from that perspective. And the way I often think about the switch I made from being very happy and fulfilled academic to being a candidate running for political office is this, that I think we all go through our lives having both front burner and back burner professional goals. And my front burner professional goals were probably very similar to yours, to get a tenure track position, to get tenure, to see if I could qualify and receive a chair, to make full professor, to be published in certain peer-reviewed journals. And those were always kind of running through my mind. And I spoke at length with my sister about her experiences in the medical field, and we often compared notes. In the back of my mind, my back burner goals were always how to make a difference in Canadian society, and was I doing enough in my front burner goals in the pursuit of those goals in terms of making a difference regarding my back burner goals? And I think when it comes to those back burner goals, your history, your life, your lessons your parents teach you and taught you make such a big difference. And so in the back of my mind, and I know my sister's also, was our mom, who continually told us that we need to give back to Canadian society. We need to do more for our communities. We need to be concerned with equity and equality. And so those were the types of motivating factors that not only pushed me forward in the front burner goals, but also in terms of considering when the time came as to whether I wanted to seek political office. And so I was asked to run for office in 2018 when the provincial Liberals were looking to be reelected. And my youngest was in high school. I have four kids, a son who's turning 25 this year, twins who just turned 23, and my youngest, who at the time was 18, she just turned 20. And I said to myself, well, she's in grade 11. It wouldn't be the right time for me to make a career change, because you know how fine a balance you have to strike when you're a working mother. We had two dogs, four kids. you know, working parents, just wasn't going to be right. So I thought maybe when she graduates from high school. So luckily I didn't seek office that election because the Liberals went down to 8 seats in the legislature. And then the next year, January 2019, someone asked me to run for the federal Liberals. And of course, when you're so happy in your life, in your as an academic, it's such an amazing way to contribute to Canadian society. I was quite reluctant. And after many, many, many conversations, I decided, well, how much could it hurt? I'll just throw my name into the ring. And if I'm not successful, it'll be all right because I love my job. And so at the time I became a candidate, I was the only person seeking election in Oakville. And so I thought, okay, well, I'm going to just waltz into this election. Then nobody else will be running against me for the nomination to be the Liberal candidate. But lo and behold, Kevin Flynn, who was a cabinet minister in the Wynne government, decided to throw his name into the hat federally. And then another lawyer decided to run as well. And so there were three of us on the ballot. And the night before this contested nomination, my husband comes over to me, John, and says, "Now, don't worry if you don't win, because we'll be okay." And I'm thinking to myself, we will be just fine. I love my job at the University of Toronto. But I won on the first ballot the next night. And I took it as a sign that people wanted change in the type of leaders that were representing them. And indeed, during that campaign, that first part of the campaign, many people asked me, "Well, do you think Oakville would elect a visible minority woman?" And I said to myself, "I don't know. It's never been done before, but let's give it a shot. And let's have faith in the people that I've been living with in this community for 17 years. So winning on the first ballot was a great, I guess, boost. But that meant that we were going to go into the general election against another incumbent. He had run many elections before and won. He had been the Conservative representative, Terrence Young. And there were four other people. So there were a lot of candidates on the ballot. And in the end, despite what was happening federally in terms of the political scene, I was able to win. And I will just say that it's been a surprise all the way along. Every time something happened, like I would win that next stage, I was shocked. And also my job at the University of Toronto was getting further and farther away from me in terms of my being able to return. And so at that stage, just before the 2019 election, I was negotiating with the administration, and I'm sure the provost will find this interesting, for, you know, I want to return. What is the agreement? Can I return after a certain number of years? We have this policy in place. It clearly only dealt with men running for political office and clearly didn't consider cabinet ministers. And so we had to do a lot of negotiating. My dean really stepped up and helped me out with that. And so it does allow me to go back to the university after a certain period of time, if I want. But anyway, so then when I got elected, that was amazing. I thought, okay, we are now really jumbling up the front burner and the back burner goals. All of a sudden, those back burner goals are right on the front burner. My front burner goals are way to the back. I am not going to be the holder of the J.R. Kimber Chair in Investor Protection and Corporate Governance, a chair that was created just for me anymore. And that was very sad for me in terms of all that I had done to work for that. And all the contribution that I thought that I could make in that field. But anyway, I decided to just try to keep focusing on what I was going to do to represent the people of Oakville, because I was running on the environmental considerations that people had talked to me about at the door. Healthcare was another one that constituents cared so much about. And so these were the kind of top level issues for me when I was running. And then a month later, I got a call from the Prime Minister's office, not telling me why I needed to go to Ottawa, but could I come to Ottawa for an interview? So I said, sure, of course. Started reading my Bhagavad Gita and all of my philosophical kind of learnings so that I really had my bearings when I went into the interview. And Anne McClellan was interviewing me with Isabelle Houdon. And it was a very good conversation, but I still wasn't quite sure what I was being interviewed for. And then I went home. And a couple weeks later, I'm in the parking garage at the Pearson Airport, jump-starting my son's car, whose battery had died. And this is, again, working mother. You are just trying to make ends meet. You're trying to fulfill the goals that your kids have. You're trying to work professionally. You're trying to make things happen at home. It's a common story, exacerbated by this pandemic for sure. And so I'm in the Pearson, trying to jump the car. My son is yelling at me, "Mom, start the car." And my phone rings and I see PMO switchboard. And I chuck my phone up in the air and I was freaking out. So they said, "You got to come to Ottawa to meet the Prime Minister." Again, I thought maybe it's about being a cabinet minister, but they already had a great Minister of Justice and thought, probably not for me. What role could I fill? I don't know. So I get there and he asks me to be the Minister of Public Services and Procurement. And I had already decided that I was going to say I would be honored no matter what I was going to be offered, because I knew that I would be so excited in that moment. I had to practice what I was going to say. So I would be honored to fill that role, even though I had really very little idea of what that role involved. So it was very emotional because, you know, I had thought just a few months earlier, how amazing would it be if I was elected and I was able to contribute to the broader Canadian community from a policy level in that role. So I left, and I'll just say that they walked me out the back entrance because there were so many photographers out the front entrance. And I'm kind of going, this is not the life of a professor, okay? Because really no one's reading your articles, at least not my articles. Even though they're peer reviewed, still 5 or 6 people are reading them, maybe cited 100 times. Certainly in law, not a lot of citations going around for most articles. So it was all very strange. Then even when we were sworn in, I was being sworn in. I used the Bhagavad Gita as my book that I swore the oath on. I thought of my mother because the swearing in was the date of her death. And she was the one that pushed us to do these types of roles, to try to fulfill these types of roles. So it was a very, very emotional day. But even that day, where we all walk out, all the cabinet ministers walk out and listen to the Prime Minister give his remarks. And I was completely, for the first time, completely overwhelmed that I couldn't really believe that I was in this new role for the first time, where I was standing behind the Prime Minister with fellow cabinet ministers about to take on a very important role for the country. This is still pre-pandemic, mind you. And so that night, I go back to my hotel room and people were saying, "Come on out for drinks." And I just couldn't. I saw myself on TV. My phones were blowing up. I was in the newspaper. I couldn't believe it. And so fast forward to March of 2020, and the pandemic hits, and my department is in charge of procuring all the PPE and all the vaccines for PHAC for the country. We put in place long-term contracts for the procurement of 2.7 billion items of PPE, including made in Canada and N95 masks, which I know the medical profession was calling out for desperately. We made sure that we had a 3M plant in Brockville up and running. We made sure we had Medicom in Montreal producing N95 masks. And now 40% of our contracts by dollar value are with Canadian manufacturers that are producing Canadian-made PPE. And that is a great, I would say, a learning lesson, an important aspect of what we did in procurement in the first wave of the pandemic. And then we moved to the second mountain. I refer to these as mountains. That was the first mountain. The second mountain was a rapid test kit procurement. We procured over 40 million rapid tests, and almost all of those have been delivered out to the provinces that are still determining ways in which they will be used. And then the third mountain, of course, this is the mountain that everybody knows me for and this backdrop, and that's the procurement of the vaccines. And regardless of what you may hear, we did not rely on China for the vaccines. We put in place seven major contracts with major vaccine suppliers for the production and delivery of vaccines. At the time, in August of last year, nobody knew if the vaccine was even going to be discovered. Nobody knew if it was going to be in regulatory approval or what that approval process would even look like. And so we get to November and Pfizer and Moderna come out with 95% efficacy rates. And we start saying to them, we need those vaccines in the country ASAP. We were one of the first countries to sign with those companies, one of the first countries to begin inoculations. Everybody says then what happened in January and February. What happened was, A, Pfizer decided to retool its plant in Belgium, and B, global supply chains were just ramping up around the world, and Canada did not have domestic production of vaccines. Despite that, we ended the quarter 3.5 million more doses than expected, and we accelerated 28 million doses to an earlier quarter, which means that we will end June with between 48 to 50 million doses of vaccine from multiple vaccine suppliers. And that's our third mountain. It's a diversified portfolio of vaccines, and they will continue to ramp up. And I'll just leave you with my worry. My worry is on the vaccine front, that we are going to get to a place where we have millions and millions of vaccines in this country, and the administration and distribution of those vaccines provincially and municipally is not going to be able to keep up. I know it may seem hard to imagine at this time, but I know the numbers, and they're going to be coming in fast and furious. 2 million doses from Pfizer a week alone in May, 2.5 million doses alone a week in the 5 weeks in June. So we need to make sure that at all levels, we are working together to get this vaccine rolled out. So I'll just leave it there to say that I'm not in a position to say yet whether this was, from a personal standpoint, the right move for me, whether the jumbling of the front burner and the back burner goals and the reconfiguration of those goals was the right thing for me personally, because there have been some very, very, very hard times during the last few months. But by the same token, I say my overarching goal was to contribute in a broader, meaningful way to Canadian society. And this role, in a very odd way, has enabled me to do that. And so I feel honored that, in a way, this was happenstance that I've been able to contribute in this way. But I will say that my ability to analyze contracts, and the fact that I taught contracts and complex contracts for 22 years, has made this job manageable. And I am very grateful, as I said to my dad by text last night, thank you for the brain that you gave us, because it has made such a difference in the last few months. So I'll just end there. Thank you so much.